St. Luke.
Good morning.
AME Church, we thank God for those who are present in the sanctuary and for those who may be joining us by way of social media. It is second Sunday in October, our late witness Sunday, and we are excited. Amen. Those who can, let us stand to our feet for the doxology. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your good.
Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God.
Blessed are they that dwell in thy house. Lord, I have loved thy habitation, the place where thy honor dwelleth.
But the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my Redeemer.
I will sing unto the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. All the earth sing praises.
Let's do so as we sing hymn number 243, Down at the Cross.
Thank you.
fly. Mm-hmm. That's why we sing glory to his name. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we come. We come with bowed heads and with humble hearts. Oh God, singing and declaring glory to your name.
Yes.
A name that is above every name. For at the name of Jesus, every knee must bow. And every tongue must confess that he is indeed Lord of all. And so this morning, dear Heavenly Father, we come singing and declaring and offering you all the glory that you're so worthy of. Now, God, we come and we realize that we are few in numbers this morning.
Yes.
But, God, we are resting assured that your presence is here with us.
Yes.
Your Holy Spirit. For you've already told us where one or two would just come together and gather in your name. There you are, right there in the midst of us. So God, we pause to tell you thank you for presence this morning. Because we know wherever your presence is, there's freedom and liberty, and captives can be set free. And so we come, God, to tell you thank you. Thank you for another day's journey. And if I would, I would say thank you for another year's journey that we have experienced here at St. Luke African Methodist Episcopal Church. Oh God, you saw fit to send me back one more year. So now, God, I come to you this morning praying not only for myself, but for St. Luke African Methodist Episcopal Church family. Oh God, I pray that you will bind us together.
Thank you, Lord.
That God, I pray that you will increase us, oh God, in number and in spirit.
Yes.
Oh God, I come praying, oh God, from the youngest of us, even to the oldest of us, for I know that we all stand in need of prayer.
Yes.
Realizing this morning that some of us need you for one thing, and somebody else need you for something else. Oh God, we come casting all cares and all of our concerns upon you. And asking you, oh God, if it be your will, to deliver us from every pitfall that the devil tries to put before us. And then, oh God, we come pray for those who are less fortunate than us. Some without food, clothing, shelter, some without blankets as we woke up to a cold morning. Oh God, we lift them up to you and ask that you continue to allow us to be our brothers and our sisters' keepers. God, we lift up those who are sick and in hospitals and even in their own homes. We know that by your stripes you've already told us that we are healed. And so now, God, we just offer a praise to you. We thank you and praise you for your healing and delivering power. And, oh, God, we lift up those behind prison bars, in jailhouses, and those who are captive to their own mind and thoughts, oh, God. We ask that you would set at free those who are in bondage from whatever it is that could be controlling them right now. And then, God, we come praying for our worship service, that by way of your Holy Spirit, oh God, that you would continue to sup with us in this place, in our prayers, in our praise, in our preaching, and even in our fellowship with one another. And oh God, we come now lifting up those war zone areas. God, you see what's happening over in Jerusalem, in Israel. God, you are the same God that delivered your children back in the Old Testament. And we know, oh God, that you are the same God that's able to deliver even right now. So God, we pray for the fires from the guns to cease, oh God. For the people, oh God, to be
need of a blessing.
Yes,
and so, God, we simply ask you to open up the windows of heaven.
Yes.
Pour out a blessing.
Yes.
That we would not even have room enough.
Yes, Lord.
To receive it.
Yes.
And God will be careful. And all that we do,
yes, Lord.
To continue to offer you all of our praise, mm-hmm. all of the glory, mm-hmm. that we know you deserve.
Yes, Lord.
It is in the matchless name,
yes,
of Jesus Christ, our Savior,
yes.
our Lord, mm-hmm. that we pray this prayer.
Yes, Lord.
If you believe that, say amen.
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 And amen. Hear our prayer.
Yes.
Oh Lord, hear our prayer. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
We will have our scripture lesson this morning coming from Sister Tiffany Williams, and following that, our Decalogue hymn and the Decalogue from Sister Althea Asher.
Okay.
All right, the key scripture today comes from 1 Peter 3:13. 3:13 through 17, and I'll be reading out the New King James Version. And who is he who will harm you if you become followers of what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed. And do not be afraid of their threats, nor be troubled. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you, with meekness and fear, having a good conscience. And when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed. For it is better, if it is the will of God, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. And that's the word of God for the people of God.
Amen.
This time we will have our Decalogue hymn, and following that, a summary of the Decalogue by Sister Althea. From all the books below the skies.
The sun to
the grace of giving. Honor the Lord with your substance and with the first fruits of all of your increase. Will a man rob God? Yet, for your sakes, he became poor, that you through his poverty might be rich. Upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by him in store, as God has prospered him. Give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. And it is more blessed to give than it is to receive. Blessed is he that considers the poor. The Lord will deliver him in time of trouble. All things come of thee, O Lord.
All things come of thee, O Lord.
And of thine own.
And of thine own.
Have we given thee.
Like you and John, we depend on y'all to enlighten us. Ain't that awful?
I have one thing, and it's more of an announcement.
Okay.
We all know about cowboys and all the stuff and all of the history that goes along with it. But I see where there is going to be something new, a different type of series coming out on Paramount Plus, and it is Lawmen, Bass Reeves. And Bass Reeves was back in the day, I can't come up with the year, the time, or anything like that. I'll share that with you later. But it will be premiering November 5th about this lawman who was made a sheriff and lawman way back in the cowboy days with all of that. So I am going to encourage women and remind you to catch it if you can, because he was a true lawman, a cowboy. At times, we never saw it. They tried to erase it. You know, they're trying to take our history out of the books and off the pages, but it is incumbent upon us to keep that in our young people's and in our own minds as a point of reference to what our place is and where we were and what we accomplished in history, not just Black history, American history.
Amen.
A Black History Moment, and with it being Day Sunday, I will read just briefly from the Connection of Lay Organization History. I'll read a portion of that. And it reads thusly, and I encourage you, those of you who have connection to the internet, to go onto the website, amelay.org/history, and there you will find the complete history. But it reads as follows. The lay organization of the African Methodist Episcopal Church is one of the newest in our church relative to our total years of existence. The organization, like many in our church, at an early age did not keep official records that would serve as a reference material. Research started with a brief history as given by former president, attorney Herbert L. Dudley of Detroit. He used his first pamphlet, History, an Official Guide of the Lay Movement. In this pamphlet, Professor states that the organized slave movement started at the General Conference in Kansas City, Missouri in 1912 with Professor Charles H. Johnson and Wilberforce as the first president. It was known as the Layman Missionary Movement. Professor Johnson traveled extensively through Louisiana, Mississippi, Alabama, etc. He wrote pamphlets, Men at Work and Layman's Missionary Movement. The organization was short-lived, and at the 1916 General Conference, not being satisfied with the progress of the Layman's Missionary Movement, the Connectional Lay College was organized with Professor Carl Roman, a noted Greek scholar at Fisk University, as president. This organization met once in 4 years at the seat of the General Conference, and only delegates to the conference were members. With this ever-changing membership, not funds, the organization did not reach the local lay members that it needed to do. Goes on to say, in 1993, at the 23rd biennial session in Columbus, Ohio, Mr. James L. Williams became the 8th president of the Connectional Lay Organization. At the 27th biennial, Mr. Arthur D. Brown of Columbus, Ohio was elected, and in 2003, at the 28th session, Mr. Jesse L. Burns of Gainesville, Florida, was appointed president due to the untimely death of President Brown. Some of the outstanding laymen who did much to pave the way for the present organization include Dr. C.B. Roman, Ira T. Bryant, publisher of Church Literature, William H. Shackelford, Professor Henry Davidson, the Honorable George W. Malone, Professor Monroe Wirtz, John Merritt, John R. Hawkins, and many others. This, you will see, is not the full history of the lay, but it states it's been a long and a gigantic struggle which had been waged by a large number of courageous laymen over the years. It is noteworthy to observe that some of the most significant, progressive, and constructive legislation enacted by the various general conferences of our church has taken place since the laymen have acquired equal representation. This has not been by accident or mere coincidence. It has been true because the influence of prestige and voting strength of the laity have been thrown behind every constructive and worthwhile movement in the lay. Our organized lay movement has, therefore, had three significant stages of growth and development. First, the early formative years under the Layman's Missionary League, organized in 1912, by Professor Charles H. Johnson Wilberforce. Second, Connectional Lay College, organized in 1916 under the leadership of Dr. Carl V. Roman of Fisk, and finally in 1946 in Connectional Layman's Organization, organized by the delegates from the Lay College, who were meeting in Little Rock, Arkansas in 1946. Today, the organized lay movement in the AME Church operates as a vital force for good. It is free, independent, and unmotivated by any desires, motives, or purpose other than the general welfare of African Methodism. So when you have time, please visit the website. It's a rich history there so that you can be further enlightened. And at this time, we will move forward with our worship service. At this time, we will have our sermonic hymn, and following that, the preaching of the word. Father God, we bow before you right now as humble as we know how, asking you to continue to be with us by way of your Holy Spirit, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, Lord. You're our strength, our rock, and our redeemer. It is in the precious and matchless name of Jesus that we pray and ask these blessings.
Amen.
This morning, just for a few moments, it is Lay Witness Sunday. And their theme for Lay Witness this year is We Are and We Do. The scripture reference chosen comes from 1 Peter chapter 3. Key verse being verse number 15. We read this scripture lesson in your hearing for our scripture reading this morning, but I will read it again from 1 Peter chapter 3, and we will include verses 13 through 15 from the New King James Version of the text. And it reads thusly, "And who is he who will harm you if you become followers of what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed. And do not be afraid of their threats, nor be troubled. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you, with meekness and fear." Verse 16 and 17, I'll read a little further, says, "And having a good conscience, that when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed. For it is better, if it is the will of God, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil." It is better to suffer for doing good than it is for doing evil. Amen?
Amen.
And so we want to take this key verse that the Lay Witness Sunday admonishes us to consider and preach from a topic, sanctified. Verse 15. And 1 Peter 3 and 15 says, "But sanctify the Lord in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is within you. And when you answer them, do it with meekness and with fear." I like the way the Message Bible reads these particular verses. And if you would, I'll read it again from the Message Bible, talking about suffering for right and wrong. It reads from the Message Bible, "If with the heart and soul you're doing good, do you think you can be stopped? Even if you suffer for doing good, you are still better off. Don't give the opposition a second thought. Through thick and thin, keep your hearts at attention and adoration before Christ your master. Be ready to speak up and tell anyone who asks you why you're living the way you are. And always with the utmost courtesy, keep a clear conscience before God, so that when people throw mud at you," anybody ever had mud thrown at them? "So when people throw mud at you, none of it will stick to you. They'll end up realizing that they're the ones who need a bath." Lord have mercy. "It's better to suffer for doing good, if that's what God wants, than to be punished for doing bad. That's what Christ did definitively."
Yes.
What did he do? He suffered because of others' sin. "The righteous one for the unrighteous ones. He went through it all, was put to death, and then made alive to bring us to God."
Yes.
I like the way that read. It said, even if we suffer for doing good and people are throwing mud at us, it won't even stick to you. Do you know that a good name is rather to be chosen than silver or gold? And I've been in conversations before when statements were made, but because the person had a good name, somebody would speak up and say, I know that's not true. They would reject the saying. It says that that won't even stick. You don't even have to be present. That's when God says, vengeance is mine, says the Lord, and I'll repay. He fights our battle. He said, the scripture says they'll end up realizing they're the ones who need a bath. The one who's trying to revile and bring your name down, they're the ones who realize that they need to be cleansed. Lord have mercy. And then it says it's better for us to suffer for doing good if that's what God's want, to be punished for doing good, because Christ did it for us, the righteous one. Suffer for the unrighteous one, that through him, his death and resurrection, we can be made alive. And so today, for a few moments, I want to talk about sanctification. Yes. Sanctification, biblical definition, means holiness. You know, the Bible tells us to be holy, for I am the great I am is holy, present tense. Not sanctimonious, a biblical definition meaning assumed and pretended holiness. But God has called us to a place of sanctification. To sanctify means to set apart as holy, which is what happens to sinners who are saved from sin by grace of God through the gift of faith. For a few moments, I want us to consider, where do we get sanctification from? Where is it produced from? I first want to submit to us that there are three phases of sanctification, and they are: one, we are positionally sanctified. At the moment of salvation, we are sanctified or set apart positionally. That is, we are saved from the ultimate penalty of sin. The moment we confess Christ and receive him, we're sanctified. So it's no longer the little storefront church that we call the sanctified folks. Because we want to get that right today. We want us to all leave here knowing that if we are confessed believers, we're sanctified too. Amen? Positionally sanctified. The next phase of sanctification, as the study that I studied under gotquestions.org says this, there's progressive sanctification. So now that I'm saved and set apart and being identified with Christ and positionally I am sanctified, then there's progressive sanctification. Well, somebody says, well, preacher, what is progressive sanctification? This begins the process whereby we are saved from the practice and power of sin, meaning that every day we're studying the word and learning to live and be more like Christ, and therefore we're able to suffer for righteousness' sake, because Christ did it, and greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. So positional sanctification, progressive sanctification from now until we are before Christ. And the last one is called final sanctification. And that is after this physical life is over. Whether we die or raptured up when he comes back, after the physical life is over, we'll be sanctified finally. That is, we will be saved from the presence of sin. Today, we as believers are in a phase of progressive sanctification, whereby we are being saved from the practice and the power of sin over our lives. Aren't you glad that God saved us and sanctified us and set us apart so that we don't have to walk in unrighteousness? So how do we get there? How, preacher, do we get to the place where we are sanctified? Sanctification is produced firstly by God. How do I know? 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, round about verse number 23 says, now may the God of peace himself
sanctify or set you apart completely, and may your whole spirit, your soul and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, because he who calls you is faithful, who also will do it. The Message Bible say, may God himself, the one who makes everything holy and whole, make you holy and whole, put you together, put your spirit, your soul, and your body, and make it fit for the master. I stop by to tell the church that according to 1 Thessalonians 5:23-24 tells us that God himself sanctifies. We are not good enough to sanctify ourselves. We can't set ourselves apart. I know sometimes we think we separate ourselves, but unless God sanctions it, unless he sanctifies us, then we have not reached that blessed state. Message Bible says, may God himself, the God who makes everything holy, your mind, your body, your soul, and your spirit. And he keeps us fit for the coming of the master. How can he do it? The one who called you is completely dependable. He's faithful and he'll do it. So no longer do we have to sometimes pick up our faith, pick up our religion, and lay it down. Not those of us who are in progressive sanctification, that we are constantly being saved from the practice of sin. We're becoming more and more like him. Every day with Jesus is sweeter. That's what the songwriter said, than the day before. That's why we're able to deal with some of the mud that is slung at us, because we're saved and we're sanctified. And that mud that's being slung won't stick to us. The scripture said those who are slinging it will realize they are the ones who need a bath. All right. So sanctification has three phases: positional, progressive, and final sanctification. It is produced by God. Scripture clearly says the God of peace himself will sanctify you. Nobody else can do it. Not the laying on of hands, not even the anointing of the oil, but God himself. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. It is also, we find that sanctification, according to Hebrews chapter 2, verse 11, reads this way. 10 says, for it is fitting for him, for whom all things, and by him whom all things are made, and bringing many sons to glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. For both he who sanctifies, that's Christ, and those who are being sanctified, that's us, are all of one. For which reason he is not ashamed to call them brethren, saying, I will declare your name to my brethren. In the midst of the assembly, I will sing praises to you. Stop by to remind the church, not only does God himself sanctifies us, but Christ, he says, for both he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified, he said, for this reason, I'm not ashamed of you. You know, when we do things that are not in the will of God, I used to hear it all the time, that we are crucifying Christ all over again. It's just like us throwing the lash and whipping him on the back all over again when we don't walk in an upright way, when we don't live in a holy way. But Christ himself, who sanctifies, and those who are with him being sanctified, he said, I won't be ashamed of you. I won't be ashamed to call you my brother. I declare your name before the other brethren and in the assembly. And again, verse 13 says, I put my trust in him. And again, here I am. I'm the children of whom God, I am part of the children of whom God has given me. Jesus spoke of himself being sanctified. So in other words, he is holy and set apart, and so are the followers, are to be similarly holy, set apart from sin and for God's use. So I'm telling us today that we're not fit for God's use until we've been set apart, and we don't get set apart until we accept him positionally as our Savior, our Lord and Savior. And so scripture says here that Jesus spoke of himself being sanctified. Mm-hmm. He's holy. He's set apart. And if we, like Jesus, are going to follow in his footsteps, then we too must be holy. We too must be sanctified and set apart and free from sin. His followers must be similarly set apart from sin, and then we'll fit for the use in God's kingdom. Can we go back to Isaiah? Before he said, send me, I'll go. He had to be sanctified, set apart. He couldn't go the way that he was. I think the scripture said he made a confession after he saw the Lord high and lifted up in his train, filled the temple. He said, whoa, I'm a man of unclean lips. And I live among people of unclean lips. What's your confession? What's my confession? He said, I'm unclean. And the angel took coal from the fire, touched the place where he said he was unclean, touched his mouth. And when God asked the question, who will go for us? It was a sanctified, set apart prophet that decreed and declared, Lord, send me, I'll go. Why? Because he had been set apart for the task. We wonder why we start something and stop it. Could it be that we are not set apart, not sanctified, and fit for service in that capacity? People who are sanctified are born again and therefore part of God's family. We are reserved and we know that the sanctifying work of the Spirit lives in us. That's why 1 Thessalonians 4:3 says the sanctified person will abstain from sin, from sexual immorality, for this is the will of God. Your sanctification, that you abstain. Can I ask a question today, and you answer with your inner voice? Am I sanctified? Am I able to abstain from sexual immorality and all types of sin? 1 Corinthians 1:2 says to the church of God that is in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints together with those in every place who call upon the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Stop by to remind the church that we are people who are called to be holy, set apart, and sanctified, fit for the kingdom of God. So how is it produced? Firstly, God produces it. Secondly, Christ himself produces sanctification in the life of the believer. And thirdly, the Holy Spirit. 1 Peter 1:2. It is a greeting that he makes to the church. He said, I, Peter, I'm an apostle on assignment. Good God Almighty. How many of us can say who we are in Christ? Peter declared, I am an apostle on assignment by Jesus the Messiah. And I'm writing to the exiles who are scattered to the four winds. Not one is missing and not one is forgotten. Why? Because God the Father has his eye on each of you and has determined by the work of sanctification of the Spirit to keep you obedient to the sacrifice of Christ, making everything good from God be yours. So we know that sanctification is produced from God. It's
produced from Christ. And what do we have now? That Jesus is in heaven, sitting on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. The scripture says that we got the Holy Spirit. My mama would say, we got the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Spirit is sanctifying us, making us come to a place of obedience. Because sanctified folks obey the law of the Lord. One scripture said, in his law do I meditate day and night. Stop by to tell the church that God's called us to a place of serving him. The lay says their theme, we are and we do, but you can't do it unless you're sanctified, unless you and I have been born again. How do we get this sanctification? Through the Father, through the Son, and through the Holy Spirit. But can I help you by telling you we get sanctified? Progressive sanctification comes through the Word of God. It comes through the truth. John 17, verses 17 through 19, said, I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, just as I'm not of the world. I do not pray that you should take them out of the world, but you should keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world. Christ says, just as I'm not of the world, sanctify them, set them apart by your truth. But what is the truth? Your word is the truth. And as you sent me into the world, I've also sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, that they also may be sanctified by the truth. You call yourself sanctified, you best know the word, because your word is truth, and the truth is sanctified. Good God Almighty, that's why we as believers become the salt in a world. We can come in and speak life and preserve those who are lost. That's why we got the word of God. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine, because when the word is in us, we become the light of the world. I mentioned a while back, when folks see us sanctified saints, they ought to see the light of the world. But the nursery rhyme said, twinkle, twinkle, little star, I see you shining, but I wonder what you are. What is the world saying about us? Do they see a people who are sanctified, set apart, and filled with the Holy Ghost, speaking truth, not only to power, but speaking truth everywhere we go? Stop by to tell the church. The scripture says, Lord, sanctify him by your truth. And in case you don't know what the truth is, not your truth, but sanctify them by your truth, the Heavenly Father's truth.
All right.
And what is his truth? Your word is truth. Stop by to remind the church on this late Sunday. We are really, and we do, because we're sanctified. What else produces sanctification, as I hasten to close? Stop by to tell you, it's Christ's blood.
All right.
Hebrews chapter 9.
All right.
Verse 11 reads this way, but Christ came as a high priest. of the good things to come with the greater and more perfect tabernacle not made by hands. This is not of this creation, not with the blood of goats, not with the blood of calves, but with his own blood, he entered into the most holy place once and for all, having obtained eternal redemption. For if the blood of bulls, if the blood of goats, if the ashes of a heifer, the sprinkling of unclean, to sanctify us for the purifying of the flesh. That was Old Testament. But how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without a spot, a blemish, nor a wrinkle. He offered himself unto God to cleanse the works of the dead works so that we could serve a living God. To be sanctified means that God been at work in our lives. Under the Old Testament, the blood of those animals were required to set some things apart. But in fact, the law requires that nearly everything be cleansed with blood. Blood was sprinkled on the tabernacle furniture. Blood was sprinkled on the priestly clothing, and blood was put on the people, but nothing could sanctify until it came in contact with the blood. Do you know that you're saved and that we're sanctified because we came in contact with the blood? These creatures of bread and wine represents the sacrificial death that Jesus did for you and I. This was a picture of the spiritual application of Christ's blood for our salvation. We've been sprinkled with his blood. The old folks would say, I've been bought with his blood. Good God Almighty. And just as the temple of the old was sanctified for God's use, now our bodies are filled with the Holy Spirit and set apart as holy, sanctified, fit for use in the kingdom. So my question remains, since you believe, have you accepted the blood atoning work of Jesus on the cross? Has he set you and me apart to make us fit for the kingdom? He said, present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. Stop by to tell the church that when we call ourselves sanctified, not sanctimonious, not a pretense, we realize that it was Christ's shed blood that sanctifies us. We realize his word is truth, and his truth sanctifies us. We realize that the Holy Spirit sanctifies us. Christ produced it. God, he sanctioned it. The last one I leave with you is through prayer. How can I remain sanctified, set apart, fit for the kingdom? Go, if nobody else goes with me. Well, 1 Peter 4:4-5 says, for every creature of God is good, and nothing is to be refused. They were looking at food, and they were calling it unclean. But the scripture says nothing is to be received as unclean, for if it is sanctified and set apart by the word of God and by prayer, it is fit, it is clean. Can I help you today by telling you that some of our forefathers, our foreparents, they sanctified what was left off the hog. They ate that and lived long lives, because the Bible says that whatever you pray over, sanctified, set it apart, you can eat it and it won't do harm to you. Stop by to tell the church, if you want to be sanctified, you wonder where sanctification comes from. It comes from praying. And who's praying? The person who's positionally sanctified, who progressively is growing in Christ, so that when he comes back, how many know he's coming back for a church without a spot?
Yes.
Blemish or wrinkle, we are and we do, because we're sanctified, holy, and set apart. Good God Almighty.
All right.
So the next time somebody asks you, are you saved? And I know the answer usually is, and Holy Ghost filled, and tell them sanctified. Set apart for good works. Because God has produced it. Christ has sanctioned it. The Holy Ghost has equipped us. The word is truth, and truth is his word. And he says, sanctify by your word. The next time you wonder, what should I do? How should I do it? Find out what the word of God says about it. I dare you to pray over it. Sanctify it and set it apart. See what God would do. Holy and consecrated. I never forget coming into the African Methodist Episcopal Church. I was born and raised Baptist. I didn't know the respect of the altar, and I leaned on it. My first trainer in the A&E Church, God bless his soul, the late Lewis William, knocked my hand off the altar rather hard, but it got my attention. He said, this isn't the place, young lady, you lay your keys and lean on. This is the place of prayer. It's the place where we can offer up prayer to God and set some things apart and walk away from it and know that God is going to handle it. And so now I flinch every time I see somebody doing something on that altar that's been consecrated and set apart, so that we can come pray, because we know the history of the AME church, where they were pulled off their knees at the altar where we're all equal. And told the blacks that they couldn't pray, and they marched out, and here we are, some 200 years later, thanking God. People are watching us. They're asking questions. There was a question posed a couple of weeks ago as to what did the anvil mean? Because they could see it as we were at the altar. Sanctified, set apart, fit for service. Don't forget to tell folks you set apart. You're holy. God has consecrated you. That's why you're fit for the task. That's why Jesus himself could go all the way to Calvary to save a wretch like you and me.
Yes.
Sanctified, set apart before he got here. The righteous one for the unrighteous ones. That's why the songwriter said, though millions have come, there's still room for one. No more calves, no more goats to be cut and sprinkled. The atoning work of Christ does it for us, and the doors of the church are open. We invite you to come if you're not sanctified and set apart. The Bible says, for God so loved the world, set apart something for us. He gave us his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. If you're here today or watching my way of social media, and you said, I'm not sanctified because I haven't received him as my Savior and my Lord, we offer Christ to you. If you're here and you need to rededicate your life, we give you that opportunity. And if you're looking for a church home, we invite you to make St. Luke AME Church Opelika your home. Would there be one? Oh God, seeing none have come, we thank you for sanctifying us. But before you sanctified us, you saved us. And so positionally, we realize we've been set apart. Progressive sanctification means I'm every day setting myself apart so that I don't yield to sin and temptation. And believing that final sanctification will come. Oh God, when you rapture the church and we see your son Jesus face to face. We give you praise, we give you honor, and we give you glory. Thank you, Jesus, for sanctifying us. We are and we do because we're sanctified. In Jesus' name we pray. And every believer ought to say amen, amen, and amen. You may be seated.
Say there's always somebody else a little worse off. If you think you're in the best place, Mama would say there's somebody else who got something a little bit better than what you have. And so we give God praise for what he has done here at St. Luke this past conference year. As we look forward to going into the new conference year, if you're listening, if you're watching, we'll share, announce from the pulpit that those who desire to serve, please contact me if you desire to serve in the same capacity that you have served this conference year. Please let me know. We have 2 weeks and we want to set the church up with the officers and put together a tentative calendar. More information to come on the date of that meeting, but I do want to announce for 2 weeks straight from the pulpit, from the platform here, that we will be setting up the church soon and hopefully within this month. So if you desire to serve this conference year, sanctified, I mean, I'm set apart to do this thing. Not gonna give up, not gonna give in, not gonna look back, because I'm sanctified and set apart for this purpose. Let me know that we can add your name to the list of officers and members who are willing to serve. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now I put it into the hands of the announcements.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good to see everybody in the house of the Lord. Please continue to pray, minister to, visit the sick and the shut in, remembering that the effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous avails much. And of course, there's our list of sick and shut-in members. If you have someone that you need to add, just let us know. We'll be happy to add them. We'll add them. We'll be happy that they're sick and shut-in. And this is our basement thermometer. And we see that it is just moving on up, moving on up. We're at 66% now. We have $23,733 that we have raised. So everybody give yourselves a hand. Thank you so much. We only have 13,000 more to go. And I know if we got 23,000, we can get 13, right?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So still, there's time for you to pledge. And if you have made pledges, then please make sure you're paying the pledges. If you have paid off your pledge, then just keep on paying until we reach the 36,000. We're not going to be mad at you. Yeah. You just keep on paying until we reach our goal. So anyway, welcome back. We would like to say welcome back to our pastor, Reverend Monique Summers. We are looking forward to another year under your stewardship, and as you as the shepherd of this flock, the angel of the house, and we are believing that this year we will go even higher in the Lord, and every round goes higher and higher. So welcome back. And from the pastor, thank you. Thanks you, Bishop Harris Seawright, for the appointment, for appointing me to the pastoral charge of St. Luke ME Church, Opelika. And thank you, St. Luke, for accepting me as pastor. This is the beginning of my 20th year in ministry and preaching the gospel, and my 7th year as pastor of historic St. Luke. To God alone belongs the glory. This year, let's embrace the 9th district's theme, a call to prophetic vision.
Amen.
And then thank you for your thoughtfulness. Your thoughtfulness is a gift. I will always treasure. Thank you for the appreciation tokens. My heart is still smiling. From Pastor Monique Summers. Today is the Connectional Lay Organization of the African Methodist Episcopal Church. We celebrate Lay Witness Sunday today. We are and we do 1 Peter 3 and 15. All right, and don't forget, restorative yoga is still going on. The second session will be October the 11th. I missed the first session because we were working at the fair, but I'm so looking forward to, after working at the fair, I really need some restorative yoga. because everything on me hurt right now. But so I got to get in there and get my restorative yoga at 6:30 on Wednesday.
And I was in attendance on last Wednesday, and I encourage all of you to come. Adrielle is a wonderful teacher, and she helped us and opened up. Not only, I asked her if yoga not only opens up your body but your spirit, and she said yes, definitely. And I could tell. I hate that I will miss it this Wednesday, but I will continue back. And again, I encourage you all to come. All of us in here can do it.
Okay. Well, I'm gonna be there because, like I said, these old bones aching. AME Church School Sunday is next Sunday, October the 15th, and I don't know. Greg has been unable to attend the last couple of weeks because he hasn't had transportation. So I don't know what kind of plans we have for church school Sunday, but anyway, we will celebrate on next Sunday, October the 15th. Also, let us all get ready for St. Luke's Praise-a-thon, yes. Worship and Praise Day, which will be October the 29th. We will have praise and worship at 11, praise-a-thon from 1 to 3 p.m. 1 to 3 p.m.? Okay. You're invited, choirs, praise singers, soloists, rap artists, gospel groups, dancers, spoken word. Okay, and this will be sponsored by St. Luke, and it will be like an old-fashioned gospel singing, but it'll be a praise service because we want to incorporate praise dancers, soloists, rap artists, all of those in there, spoken word. And it will be like an old school Jerry Lewis telethon as well. So we will be live and we will be issuing challenges to those that we know in the community. Someone will be outside. So if people want to drive by and drop off donations, we'll have that. It'll be an in-person, a Facebook Live, YouTube Live. I think that is, it'll be on Zoom, and I think that is, what that is? Live, what the other live is? Y'all tell me.
TikTok.
Mm-hmm. So we'll have all those different lives going out, broadcasting this praise-a-thon. And we're asking that if you know any groups or soloists or anyone who would like to participate in the event, that you please let us know, get them an invitation. We'll be inviting churches as well to come and worship and praise with us during that worship and praise thon hours, which I think are more like 1 to 5 instead of 1 to 3. But anyway, let us know. We're going to be sending out information to them, inviting them to come and praise with us. So we're looking forward to that event. Remember that everyone is invited and encouraged to participate in the planning calls, which will be the second one will be tomorrow night at 7 p.m. via Zoom. So we hope that you all will join in on that. Remember that October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month, and all of us know somebody somewhere that has been affected by breast cancer. So let us be mindful of that. And if there's some way, they have all kind of events for breast cancer. So do something in this month, if no other time, to support breast cancer awareness and research and all of this stuff, because I know several people that are living with metastatic breast cancer. And so, you know, we want to continue to support the research. So prayerfully soon they will have a cure for that.
Amen.
And we want to wish Christian and Colin a happy birthday. Mm-hmm. Their birthday was on Wednesday, October the 5th. They had a good day. Mm-hmm. They had cupcakes at school, and then they went to walk-ons, and then they went to Target and bought them some little gifts. So they had a happy little birthday. And Sister Jean Ross, her birthday was October the 4th. And she also had a happy birthday. So if you haven't told her happy birthday, it's still October. Mm-hmm. So you still have a chance to wish her a happy belated birthday and take her a little birthday token. I'm sure she's accepting all tokens. And on October the 15th, we'll have happy birthday, Brother Jared Vincent. Yes. He'll be approaching 30, Jesus.
Oh, wow.
Somebody help this woman. And on October the 21st, Sister Henrietta Monaghan, she will be celebrating her birthday. So we need to prepare to give our tokens and show our appreciation and love to Sister Henrietta Monaghan. We want to say congratulations to Paisley. She was student of the month for the month of September, and we are just so proud of our babies, and we are praying that they continue to keep up the good work, and hopefully we'll have something this year that we can offer them to support them in their spiritual walk as well as their academics. So, and then we'll be having the Women's Conference and 39th Annual Convention is December 1st and 2nd, 2023 at St. John's AME Church. Registration is $75, and you must register by November 1st, 2023. It says see the conference president for details, and there will be no on-site registration. So remember to, if you would like to attend the women's conference, please make sure you get your registration in by November the 1st. Okay, and if you all would look out in the vestibule, Sister Tracy Ware has donated some Our Daily Bread devotionals, and we want to thank Sister Tracy Ware for the Our Daily Bread devotionals, and just please pick up your copy. It has little short daily devotionals in there. I love them. And they are short. You can read them. It's not some long that's going to take a long time. So if you don't have but a little time, they're short, but they're very inspirational. So please pick up your copy and just enjoy the daily bread devotional. Okay. Are there any other announcements? Okay.
To announce and ask that you would, in recognition, this is also Domestic Violence Awareness Month, so I would like to ask that on next Sunday that you wear purple in recognition. After a while, you just think on me.
I'm going to say, y'all keep us in dress code.
You don't have to. Just go see what you got, what you're going to wear to church the following Sunday.
Okay,
third Sunday, we're asking for purple for domestic violence awareness. And on the fourth Sunday, breast cancer awareness, please wear pink. There'll be a reminder of some sort, and hopefully we'll...
Well, you did finish out the month. What you want us to wear on the fifth Sunday?
Oh, I don't know. You know what? Because I was going to say it's lay Sunday. That's the normal quarterly lay...
Okay.
But that's usually the late quarterly meeting, if I'm not mistaken. And it's also when we will be doing our God. So I'm going to let you wear what you want. I'm going to give you permission to wear what you want.
Started all over again for 2024. So we solicit your prayers and that we will continue.
continue to work together so that we can accomplish all of those things. Again, remember, if you're willing to serve and will serve, please text me, call me, and just let me know, because we want to get the church set up as soon as possible. Still a lot of work to be done to close out 2023 between now and December 31st. So if there are no other comments, any updates on Rena, Sister Rena, at this time?
I don't have any updates. Continue if you have a card you want to send to do so, and I will mail it to her. But that is, when I saw her, she looked good, she felt good. She just misses her church family. Mm-hmm. And I hope that she will be able to come. I maybe for, you think for the, when Alabama comes and joins in our worship, I don't know though, Rev. Summer's going to be preaching. Let's rethink that. We'll see. But I will be in contact with her goddaughter, and hopefully we can come up with a good time that she can worship with us.
Amen.
Any other comments? Concerns. If not, let us stand to our feet for the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Church universal, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body and life everlasting. Praise God, from whom all blessings
flow. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Sanctifying.
Yes.
We thank you for setting us apart for kingdom work.
Yes.
And God, we thank you for traveling grace.
Yes.
That brought us out to the house of worship safe.
Mm-hmm.
We pray for that same grace that you dispatch angels on assignment as we go to our prospective destination. Mm-hmm. Now, Lord, allow the sweet communion of your Holy Spirit to rest, rule, and abide with these your people, henceforth and forevermore. And the people of God said, amen.
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 Amen. Amen.